How can I then use slideshow only? Okay, this is better. Okay, have you heard of the fourth industrial revolution? First and second, third? I'm sure you do. First industrial revolution. Why I'm bringing up this issue today. The reason for that is the technology that we are considering and learning in this class is a leading technology. So I wanted to know where we are right now and what will come to us anytime sooner. What you are doing is actually in the fourth industrial revolution. So we'll look at that. Not going to do all issues to touch in this module, but I'm going to start with this, and then another module needs to be covered today. So two modules. And then next week, real sensors needs to be. So we'll see that. I mean, it depends on how much we cover. So first industrial revolution started late 18th centuries. Is it called the 18th centuries? Yeah, 1900 some. In England, right? So they used steam-powered mechanical manufacturing facilities. So mechanical engineering contributed to the first revolution. And after first revolution, mid or a little after, I mean, third quarter of 19th century, the second industrial revolution. From the second industrial revolution and forward, all are contributed by electrical or computer engineering. Second industrial engineering. So electric power developed, and therefore mass production became possible after that. Mass production. Well, we do not remember, right? But they said. And the third industrial revolution, that is not far away from now. So that is around time that we were born, right? Maybe before you were born, but around the time that I was born. So electronics and IT contributions to automation. So robotics came up around this time, the first robotics. And robots was implemented in a vehicle. If you see, there's like fork lanes. It's a robot arms and some digging outs and some heavy duty construction vehicles equipped with robot arms and robot legs, robots powers, right? There is no intelligence in it, but operated by human, still operated by humans, but human does not need to spend power when they work. And then the amount of work will be huge, right? Paramount. If you use shovels only, then it takes several years. But if you have that heavy-duty construction machine, then it can be done quickly, a couple of days. That is the third industrial revolution. And today, so little after 2000, very recent days, right? Then industrial revolution based on cyber physical systems. So what does that mean? That's what we are going to look at. What is fourth industrial revolution? I can find it from a book. That is a book, right? Schwab. I don't know that, but I just randomly picked up from Amazon bookstores. But there are many such books available. So if you see the book, then the fourth industrial revolution has the following features. Ubiquitous. It happens always, all everywhere. If you're thinking of sensors, then sensors can be available everywhere. Home electronic appliance, then you can see sensible sensors available. If you open the refrigerator, then it can sense. So automatically turn on the lights inside. There's a touchable sensor, right? It's an old-fashioned sensor. Temperature, of course, refrigerator, then it should have some temperatures in it. If it has ice maker, then the ice maker needs to know when to stop making ices, otherwise it's overflow. It should know how hard the ice cubics formed. Automobiles and a lot of sensors embedded already, right? Flat tire sensors. How do they know flat tire sensors? All right, pressure. Do your car has pressure. So you check the pressure, air pressure. Therefore, each wheel. So you need to have four sensors at least. If your mechanic carelessly take that out, then it's not going to work. Don't trust. So you have to make sure that you have all the sensors functioning well so that you can, you need to have a confidence. If there is no unbalanced lights, unbalanced lights on, then you simply assume that, oh, my tires are all good, right? But your confidence was made based upon the trustness of the stabilized sensors. So it is there. And gas, the level of gas, and also not only that, some car tells you how many more miles that you can run, right? Not only the level of a car, the gas, okay, half full. It doesn't mean that you can run next to 200 miles or 100 miles. but it can tell you. There's all kinds of sensors. Your smartphone has also sensors, multiple sensors already embedded. You name it, right? So mobile supercomputing. Supercomputing, super is a powerful computing or computing power is big, but also available and can be mobilized with you. First example is a smartphone, right? Artificially intelligent robots . What kind of robots that you think you can tell? Have you seen some robots? By the way, anybody knows the company name that has a leading robotics technologies?
Boston Dynamics.
Boston Dynamics.
Which you? Google.
Yeah, you know that, right? So Google is interested in acquiring Boston Dynamics. Already they acquired London-based DeepMind.
That was the AlphaGo?
AlphaGo, right. So those are all something related with artificial intelligence or AI robots, as we can see here. Why Google spend that much money and they put their all interest in AI related work. Although Apple is a little behind in that context. So Google already thought that that is the future, and the future will come very quickly. So they need to prepare. Right? Somehow, therefore, our cybersecurity program needs to tune a little bit for not only security, but also intelligence. That's what we are going to design and develop more courses, intelligent. So for example, we're still looking for adjunct or possible full-time faculty members who can teach summer course 595. I just set back a little bit. If somebody teaches, then I'll let them teach. But if nobody is available, then I'm going to take that 595 summer course. The topic that I already almost decided in my mind is deep learning. Let me tell you, the basic concept toward this, we have artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence is an intro course that you can study about something intelligent, okay? By taking it, when I was a student, we had so many artificial intelligence courses. For example, knowledge representation. Representation is very, very important. If you cannot represent, then it's very hard to identify, right? Human, we can identify, and also therefore we can differentiate cats and dogs very quickly, right? But how can you explain that to the computer so that computer can understand by looking at, let's assume that computer can look, okay? Computer has eyes so that it can see the images. But it's very hard. Computer, it's one of the weaknesses of what computer or robots can do as opposed to our human is that simple recognition. Robots have some difficulties saying this is cat, this is a dog. But humans, if you are like 3 or 2 years old babies, they can still tell, right? Hey cat, this is dog. So there is something that we have. Some more sense than any other, right? Computer may be able to do that if we find some good representation tool. How can you represent the dogs? Therefore, there will be the different representation of cats. If you have very clear representation tools, then computer quickly understand and then computer may be able to do it better than human, like AlphaGo, right? AlphaGo, there is no, there's only black and white two stones, right? So it is easy. But knowledge of representation and many others. One of them is machine learning. Machine learning. How can we make our machine so intelligent? Intelligent, then something static, that is still, we can say, intelligent. But learning is a little different. It's more like an incremental process. One time learn and no more learn, then maybe we can say intelligent. But we cannot say it is learning. It should keep learning and learning and learning. Like AlphaGo, the more games played, AlphaGo the software can be strengthened. So even developers do not know how the AlphaGo can play with human, right? They simply assume, and sometimes they are also surprised if AlphaGo can play much better than they thought. Because AlphaGo, by learning, it may be at some level that we do not know, right? That is a learning, that is machine learning. I'm talking about machine learning. After we have a machine learning, then since 2 decades ago, there is a data mining. If we have a lot of data, then how can we find some formal patterns? So data mining came up. And then there is a neural network. Like our neuron systems can be a good model that our computer can follow. So Dr. Hassabid applied neural network, not just a neural network, then maybe that is a biological term. So now we have artificial neural network. That term is also known as deep learning. So a lot of repetitions. So as the more repetitions applied, the more knowledge, more patterns, more sensing capabilities can be gained. That is the current technologies when we want to make things intelligent. Okay. self-driving cars, same thing. It was like 10 years ago when we had the first GPS navigator. So dumb at that time, right? GPS, it worked, it functions only the positioning. Never, there's no intelligence components embedded. Example for that is the following. When you drive, and I know this area better than GPS, so that I take this road, this path, so that I can get to the destination a lot faster and easier. Although my GPS navigator keeps saying that turn around and turn left, something like that. Try to guide me to the path that already designed. But I know that path where there is a lot of traffic, so that I can go the other path. If I keep doing that, let's say 3 or 4 times, then GPS needs to know, right? Therefore, oh, my driver doesn't like the path that I suggest. Therefore, okay, I need to tune to the human. But never done that, right? At that time, 10 years ago. But I do not know right now. I do not use GPS navigator anymore, because we all have a smartphone, and we look at before we drive, and then we go to the place, and if we are in trouble, then we pull up again, and we do that way, right? So there is no intelligence, but knowing the patterns driven by human driver is not really hard, right? Right? We just keep it. And then next time, when it comes to that area, then we can simply show that path rather than my reasoning. Simple intelligence may be used. But right now it's a lot more, right? So self-driving cars. So every time when the car reaches at certain points, needs to make some decisions. Make left turn, right turn, or straight, all the time. So needs to be some decision-making process needed. Neurotechnological brain, this is like a neural network. And genetic editing, genetic algorithms that I explained, I think, a couple of classes ago. I wrote one paper recent days, and if you look at biological systems, then it's like a evolution process. Then we have parents, mother and father. So crossover, so that we have offspring. We know for example, some capabilities of a mother and father. And therefore, we can compare those capabilities of offsprings, and then we can tell, oh, we have a better offsprings, or our children is worse than me, dummy. We can calculate that, right? We cannot say that by looking at one aspect. Human, we have thousands different features and aspects. So we cannot compare that. But let's assume that we can compare, right? So that we have good fitness function, which can be applied to parents and offsprings. Then we can tell, oh, we have a better offsprings, or we have a worse offsprings. So we may know that in this crossover that we have is better, in another crossover we have worse. We have some statistics. And next time, given 10 parents, we have 10 offsprings, the next cycle, by looking at, more than 10, right? Doesn't really matter the number, but we exclude some low performance, but take better performance. So I know that, these two pairs can produce better offsprings. By looking at this, then we can see, similar pair. Then we can cross over these two parents, see if we have better offsprings. So we keep doing that, okay? But one thing that we have to take into consideration is the mutation. Biological systems, there's always a mutation. It doesn't go the way that we understand, right? There's always a mutation. So we all need to think, how good I am right now? By mutation. If you are so good, okay? You can tell. I'm mutated. Okay? So mutation is another factor. In computer, how can we implement the mutation? I made that all in Python, which is good. Mutation. It's a random number generation, right? We randomly generate some numbers. Some number indicates some of the features, so it can be quick tweaking. Okay, so there is. So by looking at the random number, then we can say, there's no mutation at this time. But at another time, according to that random number, okay, there's a random number one, or this mutation. Number one means in these features, okay, that small things needs to be changed. Another random number then changes to what? Okay, all random numbers, different kinds of random numbers are applied. And then we have one mutation. Does it make sense? Yes, it makes sense, because mutation is mutation. But we cannot say mutation occurs so often. Right? We do not know when the mutation occurs. That is also randomly chosen. So all whatsoever the mutation occurs, if it is not pre-planned, and it occur if it occurs only a small spot, like 1% of a spot or 0.1%, we do not know, right? That also can be randomly chosen. So you run multiple random numbers. So by combining all such random numbers, then you can finally see that this is the mutation that occurs, okay, in our evolution. It's genetic. Genetic algorithm, or genetic editing. Changes in high speed. Everything can be in high speed right now. If you see the Wikipedia, then fourth industrial revolution has the features like this. Virtualization, interoperability, decentralization, real-time, service-oriented, and modular. So this is the impact of industrial revolution, which is, in other words, industry 4.0. Industry 4.0, in other words, the impact from industrial fourth industrial revolution is on services, business models. We will have different reliability and different productivity, different security, machine safety, product life cycles, different product life cycles, different value chains, different types of workers. Of course, we have some workers replaced by robots, right? So a lot of the current occupations will be replaced by one of the products called the robots, right? If it is not robots, then many other forms also. So what should we do?
Train the workers.
We have to find out some other occupations, right? There are always some other level of occupations needed. We do not know yet. Not long ago, there is a typist, right? Typist is good positions for women. I'm not discriminating, but there's a lot of women doing typist. It's completely gone, right? There's a zero positions available. Everybody needs to know editing. Coding, for example, right now. Coding, there's a computer scientist, the programmers. They have their specialties. So whenever we have something to program, then we ask them to do that. Like several decades ago, or whenever that I need to do a documentation, then I find out typist. And when I was a student, I did that. On campus, I posted typist needed. Then I put there, I think, one page or two pages, $50. It's not really bad money. It's better than campus work position. Like swimming pool, cleaning, but typing is a lot better. I can do it quick and $50. They leave the documents today, then I can finish it by tomorrow, and $50, one page or two pages long. It's very simple, right? There's no such jobs available now. Coding in the future, everyone can do, right? I don't know. I know for sure some countries already offered the courses from the elementary school or sometimes kindergarten. Some types of programming, coding. I know the UK. Yeah, they have that curriculum. I think Singapore and some of, I'm not sure Italy. No? Mm-hmm.
Not yet.
How do you know? You're not in kindergarten.
For my niece, they don't have this
course. For example, in South Korea, they enforce that from next year. So all from the elementary school, from the time that they read and they write, then why not write in computer language? Why only Korean, English, Chinese, Japanese? Why not Java, Python? That's one of the languages, right? So do it. So that's the future. We are in the generation leading toward that new season, right? So workers will be replaced. The coding positions may disappear. Then what kind of coding is really needed? Secure and intelligent. Secure and intelligent coding may last a little longer. For example, there's no typist positions available, but still there is a printing companies, right? They have a very high level prints, not just typing. That is needed. Sayo Economics and all others, you can read it. So let's look at ubiquitous computing. It means everywhere. Ubiquitous computing means computing everywhere, all around the environment, not just on the desktop, laptop, but even 2 minutes before you fall into sleep, you can still do something, right? I do not know you have that habit, but how do you, when you go to bed, you go to bed with empty hands or with the still smartphone? See you. Okay. Therefore, I'm not sure, I told that story to you. My wife or me, when we lay down in bed, both of us hold up one hand, the other one clicked. We never talk before we sleep. We talk to the phone. That's bad. But anyway, that's a ubiquitous.
There is mutation. We didn't do that.
This is ubiquitous. It everywhere, even on the bed. I have some computation, right? Typically implemented by wireless devices. Of course, it is wireless, right? First thing that you hold up when you wake, smartphone or water bottle?
Smartphone.
Both?
Yeah.
One hand the water bottle. My water bottle is 10 steps away, usually. Smartphone is... Yeah. Sometimes I feel so bad because I have a smartphone between me and bed. Oh, something discomfort. What is this? So some rocks. Oh, smartphone. Thrill. So we looked at this in the previous slide, but similar to that. In this case, we have the right. End of this slide, there is a degree of complexity. Degree of complexity. Okay, timeline remains the same. See, we have color here. This color is the same as here, the first. And second, then we have the same color, right? This is the second. This is the second. This is the third, first, second, and third. And fourth industrial revolution. Complexity higher. And only revolution is a low complexity. So now higher complexity, and higher and higher. So our job, what job, types of job that you want to prepare for your future should be low complexity or high complexity, or higher complexity. It should be higher complexity, right? Or you can do very low complexity if you want to live longer. No stress, no nothing. live with the nature, farming. I think future farming needs a lot of technologies also, right? I think current farming also uses a lot of technologies. One of the students in our class, in this class, but she is online, doing a greenhouse, and she explained her project to me. She's going to use three Arduino. Not sure all Arduino Uno or Arduino Yon or Bluetooth Arduinos, but anyway, the Arduinos. One Arduino controls watering systems. Another Arduino controls fan. So that greenhouse needs some air circulation because it is there are plants. Plants need to grow, so water is very, very important. And what she wants to make is the fan and waters are not operated manually, but will be turned on and off in response to some sensor data. So she's going to install, for example, humidity levels, under the soil or surface or in the air, temperature similarly, moisture, a few different sensors will be installed. So one Arduino holds those sensors. Second Arduino is controlling water system. Third Arduino controls the fan. And then those all things can be monitored and coordinated by smartphone, iPhone. It's a great idea, right? So that is that may be a future and also current intelligent farming systems. Intelligent farming systems. In the city, New York City, there is a, have you heard of that? There's entire one building that is a farmland. Yeah, one entire building, I think 10-story building. Underneath there is a, what is that? Whole Food. The first ground level, there is a Whole Food. And then all above, as a farming, there's no soil. All waters. Water and some nutrients. So water supplies all the nutrients, and all different kinds of plants grow. And all the lights are from LED. And fully controlled automatically. So what is the advantages of having that? You can consume at the production site, right? There is no, you can eat some vegetables within 10 minutes after harvest. So what they do is that they crop and it's through the conveyor belt system, it goes down to the whole food stores and is solved. So there will be more and more such buildings. And on top, there is a honeybees. So bees are flying all. The idea came from the following. At the very first time, then human builds high-rising residence high-rising buildings for residents, residential purpose. At the very first time, somebody said, "Oh, this is so ridiculous. Why do we need to live on top of someone else in multiple layers?" Now, no one asks that question. In the near future, farmlands. Why not? Because we have LED, more strong lights than sunlight.
It's against the nature. It's like...
It is they, right. And water circulates from top to bottom and then recirculates. Depending upon the vegetables, different nutrients are added to the water. And all crops systems are automatic. Everything is automatic, right? And they check all possible. I do not know how it is implemented. But anyway, that is possible. Cyber physical systems, this is more related to our work. The real physical environments here and there, right? And even vehicle and human and buildings and everything, but they are fully connected. So our physical world is not just a physical world. It is tightly coupled with the cyber world. So we cannot decouple cyber world and from physical world. At the same time, we cannot decouple cybersecurity from physical security. Cybersecurity, we can simply say, "Oh, then it happens only on the computer. I'm okay." No, it is not, right? Everything is controlled and connected through somehow the communication and computer. If you attack, then you can be attacked not only computer itself but physically you, right? We can simply think of that all vehicles are now, the more expensive vehicles are fully internet connected. More intelligent and expensive homes are now fully wired so that can be monitored and controlled remotely. If you can control your home remotely while you are at work, then can be controlled and owned by hackers as well, right? How do you know for sure that your home is only for you? Can be for someone else if it is fully wired. So while you are at work, your home can be used by hackers, okay? If your home is so luxury, then okay, let me use your home. How many hours do you work? Oh, 8 hours a day. Okay, then let me use 7 hours of your home. I can live before you come back home. I know when you come back home. All wired, right? Cyber physical systems. So our physical world is not isolated from cyber world, vice versa. They're all connected. So we can think of sensors and actuators. If we are sensing some environment, therefore we could do some act. So we have actuators. So main reason for example, back to one of our students' work, greenhouse control systems. We have sensors, right? Temperature sensors, moisture sensors. So there is a sensor component. And there is an actuator component, which is, okay, this is a time to give water. Or this is time to turn on the fan. This is time to turn off. We do not need to leave it on because for some reason it can be explained by sensors, right? Recent days, I purchased when I saw her plan of work for that greenhouse. I mean, water system can be controlled by Arduino, which is nice. But the device that I purchased, that is also new. I'm not sure you've used that before, but I thought that is good, so I purchased it. But immediately when I talked to our students, I was dummy. There is also water timer. Have you seen the water timer? All electric timer is popular, right? So you can turn on this you can set timer so it can be turned off in 1 hour. Fine, right? Anything that is supplied by anything electrical systems can be controlled by that timer. Water system. There's a water timer. So I purchased it. Because sometimes I turn on, I forgot 24 hours to my garden. So it is on and we have a party at home and then following morning when I get out and it's still on. I forgot. You have that experience, right? So I thought, I need a water timer. And then I typed it, Amazon.com, and there is a water timer. Oh, this is good. So I purchased it. I didn't install it yet, but I purchased it. I'm not sure how much I think about $50. That Arduino-based water control system all cost not exceed $50. So, there's an actuator. Reason we have sensor is because if we want to trigger our actuators properly. Okay. In this slide, you can see here water flow. That is something that you can control. You can tell, you have all the sensors available in this environment, to this environment. For example, force, load, torque, strain, pressure, so all kinds. If you say sensor at the end of each word, then that is a sensor. That sensor is available. Leak detection, possible. Not possible, it's available. Level of liquid systems? Yes, gas and automobile gas, without having that sensor, still okay. But if it is a toxic liquid, then do you think every time you open and measure? No, right? Recently, I purchased a radon sensor at home. I want to if I successfully done, I will give you some demo after the spring break. Raiden. Have you heard of Raiden? The Raiden, right? Raiden is the second, the major primary, second primary cause to what cancer? Lung cancer. Primary reason? Smoke. Second reason is radon. You know that a lot of non-smokers got lung cancer. The first thing they argue is that I've never smoked at all in my life, and my husband, my wife, neither, and in my home, no one's, and at my work, no one's. How come I got lung cancer? It's not fair! Probably at your home, as a radon. Radon is a gas emitted from soil and rock, right? So in this New York area, we have more radon than pure soil foundation area. We have a lot of rocks here. New York is a rock-based state, so a lot of radon. Sensor of radon, it's not expensive, right? It's not just a liquid, but gas sense, gas. Where is the gas? Somewhere, right? And electric and magnetic sensors, accelerations and tilt sensors. Tilt sensor, I have that in my office. You can also play with that. Accelerator, we do not have. Machine vision sensor, what is it? Camera. Optical ambient light. And also I purchased LED sensors, LED emitting and LED receiving. So recipient in sender and receiver. I think I purchased 5 sets. It's very cheap. 5 sets for about $5 or $6. I simply ordered it. If the department does not reimburse, that's okay. It's big. I mean, small money, right? Position, presence, proximity. Oh, we have a proximity sensors. We do not have to worry about. Motion. Velocity and displacement. Velocity and motion are similar to this. It's also possible. Some temperature and humidity and moisture. We have this also so that you can play with. Acoustic sound vibrations and chemical gas. We have here gas, right? Another module that I posted today, I think I put the title, some sense of physics, right? So it's not just the physics. I make it hard by saying sense of physics, but it's not really physics, don't be afraid. Some slides, some sensors explained about some underlying physics. Yeah, how, for example, if it is a photo cell, so that you can detect the lights, then how that photo cell sensor detect the level of lights? What is the physics behind? Simple physics described on that slide. Okay, now sensors. Because of sensors, then we know this is a new revolution. Okay, new revolution. A supply chain mechanism. If you are running a manufacturer company, then when you do manufacture, the only the critical issue is that if you have overflow inventory, then that much loss, right? If you are short, then you cannot supply, so that you lose chance making more money. So there's a supply chain. These days, some companies all over the world, they have very automatic sensors reporting the level of inventories, so that it is reported to the assembly lines, so that they produce immediately when they receive some, when they identify, when they recognized some shortages at this place or some surplus on another place or whatsoever, they can manage it, always optimal. One of the such companies is called the Caterpillar. Caterpillar is a heavy-duty engineering tools. I think one of presidential it's not nominated, but a guy is talking about that, right? Some Caterpillar. I know that companies, but that companies, each the robots of that heavy duty construction vehicles, robot. Each joints there is a sensor already embedded. So if that joint is aging, so may be able to be or needs to be replaced in next couple of months, then it automatically sends the signal. So they produce more that joints or some parts. That is industrial revolution, right? So what they do is they send out that parts to the place near that is working. So both satisfaction, the user, unless otherwise, they cannot continue to work, right? They have to wait until the parts arrives. So a lot of difficulties. And seller, they do not know who needs these parts. But if they know each other, no, not each other. I mean, that is all managed and monitored by the manufacturer, the company. Company knows who needs what parts, how soon. So send their parts before they need, so that when it is broken, then they can get it quick, and then there is a shortest latency time. So that is the contribution from sensors, sensor technologies. Sensors may be battery powered or derived energy wirelessly. Only the problem of sensors usually is battery. Not necessarily enough for batteries.
Do you need a battery?
Speaking of battery.
Oh, thank you. I have it here. See, this is well prepared. The thing is this, even if I plugged this, it should not rely on this not starting charging until it drops a certain percentage. I do not want to recharge at the level of, for example, more than 20%. Then what happens is that, I mean, depends on the battery. I'm not sure the batteries used for this Mac is really highly sophisticated. I mean, very expensive. But if it's not expensive batteries, like the batteries used for our current iPhone, then if you keep charging, recharging at the level, not at the low level, but high level, then if you do that several months, then your full capacity of a battery is from that, the time that you charged. If you keep charging at the battery 30%, then full capacity of your battery is the rest, which is 70%. That's the physics. You probably learned it in elementary school. You forgot. What principle is? Some principles. But anyway, so the new technology is that if you charge it, then battery, first thing that battery need to do before recharge is to discharge. Completely discharge it, but that is another technology. How discharge quickly? Normally it takes 3 hours. Right. So it needs some technology. So expensive. So some batteries, if you charge it, then it quick discharge it, and then charge it from certain level, I think 10%. So usually batteries 90% capacity. Okay, may use wireless and wired communication. If you want to communicate from your cell phone, then you have to think of the communication protocols of available at your cell phone. Cell phone has how many communications? How many different protocols? Yeah. First of all, it's a Bluetooth and Wi-Fi and cell. Three kinds of protocols available.
In terms of transmitting
or and also receiving. Usually, phone signals using cell signals. If we use some other apps, therefore using that app, then it goes through Wi-Fi, which is VoIP, voice over IP, right? It's not cell. Text usually go through cell signals. It is not, I mean, iPhone text, that's what I'm saying. But some other text using other third vendor app, then it is over IP. So either IP or cell signals. And then, for the short distance communication, it has also Bluetooth. In the future, in the near future, there may be some others available. I heard, I think a couple of years ago when I taught sensor technology, but I didn't see that products. But Samsung said that they will have one more protocols, communication protocols, implemented in their the device. But I do not see that. Of course, I do not use many of those. What it means is that XB communication, so IEEE 15.4, but XB, the big distance between XB and Bluetooth is that Bluetooth works only the short distance. I think 100 feet, right? That is the distance properly Bluetooth can work. XB, the maximum, I think, 2 miles away, which is very, very good, right? So if you have XB communication, then there's no problem of communicating from your health equipment to your smartphone, doctor's smartphone, which is reasonable distance, right? Any big hospitals boundary is not longer than 2 miles, right? Usually within a mile. Bork Hospital, half miles? Not even half miles, right? Yeah, short distance. But Bluetooth is impossible. Therefore, XB communication is maybe needed, but we're not at that point yet. But in the future,
we don't have XB communication.
Yeah, smartphone does not have XB protocols. But will be. Then we'll have a 4. Meanwhile, Norwegian company is called the Norwegian Semiconductor Company, developed a very, very strong and reliable transceivers, like antennas. I purchased the two kinds. Remember the cell GPRS that is developed by that. And Wi-Fi that I purchased the 3 pieces. That's also reliable. It is within that distance, like 100 feet, but data signals is very strong, so we can practice that. Maybe active and passive. What does that mean is that a passive sensor and active sensor. Passive sensors is usually we need to send out signals, but we need to continually send out. Therefore, compared the data compared with the previous. Therefore, we can sense. What is such a sensors that we can say that is a passive sensor? For example, motion detect. If you detect only one scene, then do you think it is moving? Motion detects that at least you have 2 scenes, right? So one scene here at this position, and then the very next scene is some of the transition from that, then we can say, oh, it's moved. That object is moving. Therefore, we can detect some movement occurs there. By nature, that kind of a sensor is called the passive sensor. Okay? It's not called the active sensor. It is called the passive sensor. Sensor itself, by having one sensor data, we cannot tell anything. So sensor can do anything. only some of the program can tell one data from one time one and another data at time two. Therefore, we can tell, oh, there is a movement. That's from the sensor's point of view, it is nothing, right? That's why it is a passive sensor. There are so many such sensors available. What are those sensors? Camera is not passive sensor, it's active sensor, right? You take one photo, that's it, right? You don't need to take two photos, therefore, oh, I have one photo. Two shots, therefore, I have one photo. No such photos, photos available, right? So that is active sensor. Anything that you need to apply, Einstein's relativity principles, some relations, right? Then that is all passive sensors. So there is a contribution from Einstein. GPS, of course, that is passive sensor. You cannot say that may push information or pulled for information from, I think we need to speed up. Wireless sensors, and some of the microcontrollers also may have this. So all kinds of sensors, if you see inside electronic circuits, then it's much like that. This is a portal. This is ultra compact and temperature and humidity. We have some sensors. I'm going to bring. Okay, hold on. So we have sensors.
How much does it cost for this kit?
I don't know. I'm not sure. This is, I don't know. Some of the sensors that, what are we talking about? This is usually the humidity. And there is some sensors, so I'm going to pass these sensors around so that you can see some of the explanation here. Do not misplace. If you misplace this, then we'll lose. So this tells you, for example, here joystick and so on and so forth. So take a look. And if you are interested in here, then you can take a look some and then put it back to the place that you picked up. So we have many of these available.
Yes.
So so those are the sensors. And if you look at each sensor, then there is a pin. There are pins. In this case, four pins. Four legs, right? Four pins. So each pin, there's some indication what it is. If, it, for example, A0, D0, then those are the data that you can capture. And two pins say G and plus. G is like neutral ground. and then plus means there is a power supply plus. So the best way that you need to do is you need to make sure all the specifications, all the explanations from the internet, and you need to have a proper, accurate wires. Wiring is important. If you wire them not in the correct way, then sensor will burn out quickly. So those are the sensors. Industry 4.0, some of the features here that I want you to point out here is that sensor, it uses the sensors so that we are aware of some, right? And they are connected. And also intelligent. Intelligent is big components on the fourth revolution, and responsive. Any one of these is missing, then it's not really a big impact, right? We know for sure, you know, it is intelligent. We are responsive, but they are not connected, then what does that mean? Anything, right? Everything, but if they are not, everything, if they are not intelligent, then dummy reaction. So all the time it actuates some, but so ridiculous, bad impact. Smart factories, eventually, possible. And supply chain, I explained that to you with the example of a Caterpillar case. It's a supply chain. And finally, smart objects, a small, usual, low-cost computer that may contain sensor, actuator, and communications. The component of that is a sensor, actuator, and then communication. More in wireless communication. This device is embedded into an object, then we call it smart object. Those can be embedded in car, engines, so engine can be intelligent. And all others. Smart objects are highly constrained in physical size, CPU power, memory, bandwidth. So although we are using Arduino Uno is big size, right? But still okay. But if you want to embed all in one smart object, then there is a small Arduino product is also possible. It's a mini Arduino. Very, very tiny, small. Your fingertip is small, right? It is a limited, but it works. Our Arduino Uno, it has, I think, 256K memory, EEPROM memory. We can also use that memory. I've done that when we, last year, when we had a high school, it's not high school, but summer camp. And when I use a drone and we embed our sensor and microcontroller in it. And when it flies, we cannot communicate, so that save it on that EEPROM. EEPROM is one of the Arduino ROM. So save it. When it lands, we can take that data out from there. So that is possible. But only problem is it has a limited space, 256K byte. So that if you save all the data, sensor data, then it runs, rewrite. So that you need to have some intelligence of, you need to make an intelligent coding. So what you need to do is that only if there is a big change, store. Other than that, keep sensing. Okay, keep collecting. So compare with the previous, if it is big change, save. Other than that, keep going. Then if it runs 10 minutes, still 10 minutes, and then we collect the data every 1,000 nanosecond, therefore millisecond. Right? Yeah, millisecond. So very quick. Oh, there's 1,000 millisecond. So kilosecond. Oh, what is it? Okay, whatever that is, we can collect. Okay, power consumption is critical. So these days, there is a solar power is available, and also very cheap solar. So in this summer, I'm going to install some solar panels in my home. Not the rooftop solars, but some of the sensors that I want, sensor that I install outside, I cannot supply that, right? It's not really expensive. If you spent about $100, then you can turn on your surveillance camera, 4 surveillance cameras, all the way. Okay, wireless surveillance camera. So you don't have to wire. You can still see inside, outside the scenes, from inside, outside the scenes. Batteries, wireless capabilities. Yeah, there's a low power lossy network. Low power, which means it doesn't consume the big power. Lossy network means if it is a lossless, then there's two kinds of networks. Lossy network means even if signal is lost, still okay. In many cases, right? Especially sensors. What that means is that if the data dropped, then that's okay, you still receive it. Lossless, then a lot of overhead involved. So we do not do lossless. Lossy network, which means anyway, data is streaming data. Data continue to come in, then why should we care about something that we missed while new data still coming in, right? So we're still receiving. Body sensors is also available. So what I also purchased.
Swallowable camera.
That's a good idea. Some other health-related body sensors, very, very expensive, but I found cheap but meaningful. So muscle detection. It is called electromyography. That is called EMG. I think rehab hospital needs a lot of EMG sensing capabilities. Because muscle is very, very important, right? If you have a muscle pain, then it's a real problem. So it is a chip, about $35, and electrode, 6 extra electrode cost of us, I think, $6. So $1 each. Electrode is something that you have to attach. So total about not more than $50. It'll be arrived, I'm not sure. Maybe Saturday or Monday. I'll show it to you. RFID, this is very common these days, right? In the hospital. And then intelligent pharmaceuticals. If you take some pills and digestible pills, digestible devices mingled with the pills so that when it's observed by our organ, so that remotely we may know that where that medicine is working, so that we can tell. As Eric said, if we have some cameras, then we can see all inside. Then we can tell, oh, why did you eat this before you take this? You have too much hamburgers. Real-time hospital locating systems. It's all sensor related. I think this is it, because this is very self-understandable, so you can take a look at them, but I'm going to stop this module, and we'll take about 10-minute break. When we come back, we'll get into a little deeper level of sensors, okay? Next module is the wireless sensor physics. Before we get to that wireless sensor physics, some of you may want to, if you have Arduino already in, and try to program some of those, then you can download the IDE, Integrated Desktop Edition, IDE, some editor, can be downloaded from arduino.cc/hu/main/software. If you do not remember this, then you can simply type Arduino IDE. Then you can, you simply download it. You do not need to install, I guess. It is a pre-compiled, it is a binary file. You need to download the proper ones. If you download for Windows or Mac, then you may be able to have this icon. So if you click that icon, then you can see the editor. This is the editor. Okay. So it gives you a skeleton of the program. If you see this skeleton, Actually, there are two modules given. Okay, two modules. First module is a setup. Another module is a loop. Okay. Similar, the beauty of these two modules is that once you set up some components, this is the initial setup, and then whatever the series of actions that you specify within this loop function will perform endlessly. There is a loop. It performs continually. It performs continually, endlessly on behalf of us. Therefore, it will monitor the natural environment seamlessly. And if you program well in a way, there is a proper actuator can take into consideration, then it is a perfect sensor networks. Okay. So basic idea of this sensor programming is in this way: initial setup and then loop. Whatever you do, you need to do inside. If it is some sequence of actions that you want it to perform continually, should be in this loop. Anything that you initially set up, then should be here in this setup. Usually, the communication needs to be set up here. If it is what ports and what baud rates and all such specifications needs to be here. And outside of those two functions, there you need to say any declarations. For example, pin number 5 is what? Pin number 2, what? Okay? Such things needs to be specified outside those two modules. That is more static. But if you want to keep changing some of the pins, then you may need to do that in those two functions, maybe in this loop functions. But I've never done that in my life. This is it. Exact the same concept has been used by Media Lab at MIT. They made a new language. There's a web. Interactive web language. It's called the processing 5. JavaScript. What it does is that any animations that you can do in those two functions and then put it on your web server, then your web server waits for you to interactively involve. Same mechanism. Your web server is performing like microcontroller. Microcontroller keep monitoring some of the environments and sending the proper data back to you. That is the whole concept, right? And if there is some actuations, then actuator needs to be involved. In the similar way, in web programming, something is already in the server. So if you access that web server, then there is, for example, graphical components like animations or game appears on the web. It is looping continually. So whenever you involve, click some, then it's connected with you interactively. That is future, what is the current? Uh, another evolution of the program. Okay, so we'll come back to this issue later, but today, sense of physics. Okay. What is a sensor? Sensor is a device that is to detect events and changes of objects and provide an output. That's the definition of sensors. So if I depict this definition in a diagram, it is like this. There is some box. There's input and output. It's a sensor. But this sensor is not, this box is not just any black box, but so-called transducer. Transducer. What does that mean? It should convert from one form, convert data in one form to another. There's a transducer. Right? There's a data in one form, needs to be converted to the same value but in another form. If it is electric signals, like voltage, then what does that mean, voltage in motion detection? It doesn't mean, right? So that we have to interpret it in a way that we can understand. Okay. Signals in here can be electric energy or magnetic energy or optical energy or thermal energies, anything. Stimulus to sensors. That energy comes from some objects. This is the same diagram that we looked at. Some stimulus. Stimulus may be some sound, some electric power, magnetic, optical, thermal, mechanical, more and more, right? Some motor units, our bodies. Muscle has motor units. So EMG, let's say that is the sensor, then EMG, if we move, okay, then our muscle is moving, some motor units. So motor units is an object that stimulate our sensor, so that our sensor, if it is electromagnetic based signals, then there's some changes of the electrical signals. Acoustic, we have waves. Wave, then there is the amplitude, phase, polarization, some spectrum, wave velocity. Electric stimulus, then electrical charge, current, potential, voltage, electric fields, conductivity and permittivity. Magnetic?
What would potential be? Like, that would be like the energy stored in a capacitor, or?
That's a good question. Potential, I think some level of, potential voltages or potential current. Potential charge. Frankly, I've never thought of that. I just keep receiving it. Magnetic fields. Magnetic fields has amplitude, phase, polarization, and spectrum. And magnetic flux, some flows, and permeability. Optical. optical is also a wave. So it has amplitude, phase, polarization, spectrum, and wave velocity, and reflective index. If that optical wave, like lights, doesn't penetrate, then it reflects partially, total, or none. Emissivity, reflexivity, absorption, thermal, there's a temperature, thermal flux, like high temperature goes to low temperature. Specific heat, thermal conductivity, mechanical stimulus, mechanical position changes, acceleration, force, stress, press, strain, mass, density, moment, torque, shape, roughness, orientation, stiffness, compliance, crystallicity, structural, all kinds of mechanical changes can stimulate sensor. So situation is called a phenomenon when a set of sensors reports similar reading values more than x times within a time window w. What it does is that, remember that passive sensor, then it's tracing, it sends out some signals, whatever signal that is, right? And it, sometimes it uses the reflexive data, so that we have a reflexive data from time t1 and another reflexive data time t2. Therefore, we can detect. If it is detected, then reports. In response to that reporting, some actuator may be involved. Okay. That actuator may come back to the same objects or to another object. That is possible. If we have some actuator here, then it can come back to this object or another. In response to this stimulus, you may do some other actions. So let's first of all think of acoustic sensors. Acoustic sensor, then it's called so-called ultrasonic sound is emitted. Sound signals. Little bit of ultra, therefore higher frequency than sound. Little bit above. That's ultrasound. Ultrasonic. It's similar to our sound, acoustic. Sensing, it is used for sensing water depth, sensing thickness of a painting. That is very, very important, right? Thickness of a painting. Why it is important? Especially in New York, like 100 years old the buildings. How many times is painted? I don't see any paint. When they paint, they scratch out to the original material and paint. They just repaint, right? How many years? 100 years. Then how thick it is? We do not know. But ultrasonic can penetrate. So they can, as it first hit the surface, then a little bit of reflection. Not all penetrate, but all reflects or never reflects, absorbed at the concrete or metal, right? So by looking at those difference in distance, we can see the thinness. But in this case, we will look at the distance. How can this sensor works? So you can see some reference there, and here is the physics behind. Very simple physics. What is the speed of sound? 340 meter per second, which means we need to change this to real Americans.
Yeah, we are fine with meters. I'm definitely
fine. I think military background may use, right? Meter and centimeter. 340 meter means 1 meter, and there's a 3 feet. 1 meter, 3. So times 3. So about 1,000 feet per second. A little bit over 1,000 feet per second. So if you shout here, then if somebody is 1,000 feet away, then that guy can hear your voice 1 second later.
If there is no obstacle.
If there is no obstacle, right. This distance sensor, distance sonar sensor, we have many of this. Not only the sensors in the box, I have a few others. So we're going to use this. It's very, very interesting things. So here's a question. You have that sensor here. The object is 10 centimeter away. To detect the 10 centimeter away distance, how long does it take from trigger to echo? What it does is that this distance sonar sensor has two devices. One device is called the trigger, another device is called the echo. Trigger is to emit sonar signals, and echo receives the sonar signals. This guy keeps sending out, this guy keeps receiving. So the signal that departed from this trigger traverses 10 centimeter after he hits the objects, and it should travel another 10 centimeter so that the echo components can receive. So total 20 centimeter travels, right? If it travels 20 centimeter, then how long does it take according to this? 340 meter per second. Look at this. The formula is this. Velocity is it's a length over time, right? I think we need to say this. Ys, I think length, L over. What distance? L over. If we multiply both sides by T, then VT equals L. So T can be cancelled out. And if we divide both sides by B, then B can be canceled out at the left side. So T equals L over B. That is what this means, which means how long does it take? If we have, how long does it travel? 20. Distance? 20. So 20 centimeter divided by velocity. Velocity is fixed. 340 meter per second or 0.034 centimeter per microsecond. So we have to divide that 0.034 centimeter. Whatever that we have, that is a microsecond. If we convert that to a second, then we know what it does. Yes. So it's 0.05 seconds?
0.05 seconds.
0.05 seconds. Yeah, about that. Yeah. So we cannot sense that short time distance. If it is a longer, then we can identify the distance, right? But each sensor has its own capacity. This sensor, why this is its own specific a capacity? Because sensor needs to emit the sonar signals. There is a strength. Sonar signal has energy. So depending upon the energy that we push it out, it may reach a different distance, right? If you have a big energy to use, then it can reach for the longer. If you have a small energy, because if we have only 3.3 voltages or 5 voltages, like using our Arduino Uno, then it doesn't go further. Usually maybe 2 feet or 3 feet that long. 10 centimeter is 1/3 foot short, right? Like this. It takes 0.05 second.
0.05 second.
Yeah. 0.05 seconds. Almost, human cannot recognize this. So this is a physics. So one component here sending out, emitting the sonar signals, in another receiving it, and internally it calculates. Depending upon the sensors, it may tell you only the time difference, then you have to calculate in this way to find out the length. What some other sensor tells you the length itself. If it has some processors in it and computes, and then output is only distance. But chip one, only time difference, then you have to calculate in your Arduino Uno programming. Which is a C, right? If you look at this here, so this is not the case. Usually, 4 pins. Let me find out if it is. It's not.
save time, I think I'll...
We'll practice that anyway next time. Okay? If you look this very closely, then there is a pin called the echo and trig. The inner two pins for trigger and echo. So probably left side of this element triggers and right side receives the signals. And then one of them is, I think this is ground, so-called GND. And then the other one is VCC. This is a power supply. Mm-hmm. So you need to wire using the jumper cable. Because we do not have much complexity here, simply you can plug this with no breadboard. Maybe possible. Okay, this is the physics behind. LED. So LED is an acronym for light emitting diode. So what is LED? LED is nothing but diode. What is diode? Typically, Pamela? What diode can do?
It's a pin. Diode is a part of the material, part of the physical chip. It's like a chip you can use it for.
Which is for?
For light, for diode.
Okay.
Uses for the light.
Usually it's a switch, right? Turn on and off, on and off. That's a diode. Like this. Do you remember this?
Oh,
this
yeah.
Switch. Yeah. So there's a diode. Diode is essentially a PN junction, positive negative junction, opter semiconductor that emits monochromatic light when operated in a forward biased direction. So if it goes this, then it is on, otherwise off, on and off, on and off. LEDs converts electrical energy to light energy. Electrical energy to light energy. Some transducer. They are frequently used as a pilot light in electronic appliances to indicate whether the circuit is closed or not. So LEDs is used a lot in so many applications. It is on, then light is going out, right? When light is emitting, then before light is projecting, if you can modulate, mix with the data, then data can travel over light. That is a remote controller. Usually, remote controller is this. Your car key, car remote controller also use that. But the lights is off these days, right? Light, yeah, lights. I don't have lights. But this is the same signals. Some physics. There's a positive and negative electronics. There is a junction. So sometimes there's a current flows. Some other times it stops. And if there is a current, then we change that electric energy to light energy. Okay? So you can read it. If you do not understand, you'll be in big trouble? No, don't worry. just for your reference. If you are interested in, you can read it. If you do not understand, perfectly fine. Me neither. So, just physics, okay? We'll be fine without understanding physics, right? Anybody has any problem living on this globe without understanding fully about physics? No, right? Yeah. We can still drive cars. We can eat hamburgers with no physics. How does the LED works? That explains. Okay, here. This is what I purchased. I said, I think about $7. It's not $1 each. It's a pair. See here, this is LED. I'll show it to you next time, right? So we'll do some programs. So this guy, lights emits, right? By having this, you can receive it. This technique, if you have these two, then you can communicate. Like if you have a TV controller, remote controller, and there's a TV set. TV sets, you have this. I might your remote controller, you have this LED. And then TV controllers do not need to receive a whole lot of different kinds of data. It needs only a few preset data, right? On, off, changing tune, and volume, usually. If you see that, then it's not really much, right? Tuning is only moving up and down and up and down, fine. But these days, the controller is more complex, right? There is a touch keyboard, and that is complicated. But our experiment is simply receiving lights. So it is called the infrared signals. So frequency-wise, that is infrared. It's a light. It's not sound. Previously, the distance detector, that is an ultrasonic sensor, right? It's very, very low frequencies. Our sound is a low frequency. Light is a lot higher. Infrared is lights, it's multiple spectrum, but there is a lowest frequency in that light spectrum. There's a red light, and there is a little low frequencies than red frequency. It is called infrared. It's a little bit lower than light. So that is being used by this. And if you are interested in some of the dimensions, this is it, but I am not. And this is something that I am interested in, and so do you. See here, we have an LED, okay? And switch if you want. I'm not sure, this is not switch, but anyway, we have an LED. LED emit the lights. We have here receiver of that ones. This receiver has three pins. One pin is for power supply. Another pin is the ground. And only one pin through which we can collect sensor data. And in your programs, you need to set up, hey, I'm going to use pin number 2 to receive, to read the data. By the way, this side is for digital data. This is all here analog data. The data that I am receiving is digital data. So I might have some number. Okay? It's not analog. Okay, this is LED sensor. Any questions so far? We have distance detector and light sensor. This is a light communication through LED. Another light sensor is a photocell. Tells about the degree of light. Resistor that changes its resistive value depending on how much light is shining onto the surface. I don't know. Squiggly face? Maybe you guys know. This is the face. So if you have lights, then we have two pins, right? Two pins. So we can read the level of the lights from those two pins. This photocell, this sensor, do you see the difference from the previous two?
Shape, of course.
Well, the LED just goes on and off. This actually has the ability to change. The LED, it's either the LED before was just on or off. The resist, there's a resistor.
Yeah, that's right. And any other?
Have the degree of light for the LED. It's just a regular one.
Right.
Just one and off.
Yeah, that's what it says.
So for that, here we have multiple. So we can calculate it or just adjust that with the resistor, with changing the mm-hmm. degrees of shining.
Any other difference? The other two sensors needs power. There's a pin so that we supply the power. Remember that distance, we had four pins.
Yeah.
See, four pins.
Yeah.
And then LED. Usually two or three pins, but it is power, plus and minus. But here, it uses light. Okay? So simply we received data from there. Does not need
power.
Because of light. It responds to light. Light is power. All it has already energy. Only we see the resistance. What this guy uses energy. Oh, that's fine. Yeah, some cases it needs, right? This guy, oops. This 5 volts comes in and then
As
you said, the data that we receive is analog. It's a multi-layer. Previously,
before
we have digital.
Digital.
Yeah. Using LED and photocell together. Force-sensitive resistor. For example, if you touch it and press it, so that it can tell you. Okay? Like this. It's not really button, but if you touch it a little bit, press. Our cell phone, is it like that?
Yeah.
But this button is a real button, right?
Yeah, I think the touch
but,
screen.
But yeah, touch screen is like that. Like force sensitive resistor. So how to measure? When there is no pressure, the sensor looks like an infinite resistor. Infinite resistor, there is no current. Because there infinite resistor, that therefore no current.
Open.
So closed. That open, yeah. Open. So if you press it, then lower the resistor, therefore circuit will be closed. This is some specifications. The power, the force, the level of force, 0.04 pounds or 22 pounds, therefore different resistor, so less weight than more resistance. If you heavy weight, then less resistance, lower resistance, therefore more current can flow, which means more more amp. Circuit is very simple, right? How many pins? 3 pins or 2 pins. In this case, I don't know. It depends on. I do not have this. Temperature. Ground and voltage. In the middle pin, we can read analog voltage out. So voltage is the output. Then what we need to do is that this sensor can sense, I think, we need to convert this voltage divided by 1024 means 1 byte. Divided by 1024, and it'll be a millivolts. The level of I think there's some is a manufacturer. The specifications. So subtract 500, which means the voltages. If that is a frozen level, then it'll be 500 millivoltages, I guess. That's what it is, right? So it's a little higher the temperature, then it flows a little higher voltages. So we subtract 500. Well, actually, I think 50, right? Real temperature. So that we divide by 10. This is some the calibration from the manufacturer.
What is Professor ABC?
I think analog to,
digital.
Yeah, digital converter. Analog to digital, the level of analog is 1024. Because again, this voltage is, I think, maximum, maybe, yeah, somehow, I don't know. Some of the voltages, let's say, voltages like this, then we divide this by 1024. So we digitize that to 1024 and convert that to. What it does is that any in between these two levels, we can choose either lower bound or upper bound. That's what it does here, this denominator. 1024, then anything in detail there, I want to make it either upper bound or lower bound, so that I have a limited number, rather than, I would have a discrete number than continuous numbers. So once I have a discrete number, then I can tell that the temperature precisely. I cannot say, oh, temperature is somewhere here, here, there. Then I can say, oh, this is 32 degree or 10 degree. What, 10 degree or 11 degree. The sketch of that wires is like this, and also it needs three pins, voltage and ground and analog. Okay, because the temperature, the sensor itself does not give you, although we are prefer to have a number of temperature, right? 10 degrees Celsius or 11 degrees Celsius. We do not say that 10.1234567 8 whatever the number, right? So we divide that into divide it by 1024 and then subtract 500. Why? Because voltages, the amount of voltages flow based up, depending upon the temperature. If it's a low temperature, then low voltage flows. The high temperature, then more voltages flows. So in some physics math, we have that formula. So in your program, you have to use this, but not all IR temperature and temperature sensor uses this. Every time when you use a sensor, then you have to read the specification about that sensor so that you can program it properly. Again, this is an analog. I think we need to stop. Tilt and all others. Next time we'll do. I'm going to bring more sensors so that you can touch, and also Arduino Uno so that we will practice a little bit from next time. Okay. Possibly at Manhattan. Do you prefer to stay here or Manhattan?
I'm biased.
I'm in the Bronx, so I'm in Manhattan. Yeah. So we move back and forth as it's scheduled.
So next week is here?
Next week, Manhattan, yeah. Which means I have to carry all the sensors next week. That's okay.